Kim Richie. I'm a technician here at CERC, and the project we're working on is the river herring habitat use. One of the goals of this project is to learn about river herring population numbers and what habitats and what streams are they using to spawn. So river herring is a collective term to describe the two species of fish, alewife and blueback herring. They're very similar in appearance, but you know, if you start dissecting them, you can tell some differences, and then obviously genetically they're different because they're different species. For our study, we used three different sampling methods. We did a visual observation, just looking around the stream. Are they here? Do I see any swimming around? We just kind of observed that they seem to be in the deep holes during the day just because it's such a shallow system and the water is so clear. And then we did environmental DNA, so that's eDNA, and that you just take a water sample and it gets processed later, so that any DNA that the fish are giving off, whether that's gametes or scales, like mucus that they might have on their skin, anything that would be in the water would show up. And then ichthyoplankton samples, so that's collecting anything that's just floating in the system. So eggs, larvae, leaves, insects that would stay in the water for 5 minutes and just hold a net in the bottom of the water column, and it just collects eggs and larvae that are floating downstream. So once we've collected the ichthyoplankton, it gets preserved in ethanol just to keep the eggs intact. And then it comes back to the lab and it gets analyzed, goes under a microscope, and we have bring in citizen scientists to sit and pick out the eggs and larvae and count them. We sample 2 times a year, once for the alewife run and then later in the spring for the blueback run. So between the years of 2014 to 2017, we sampled 15 tributaries. In the Chesapeake River, we have sites that are below Bloody Dam and sites above Bloody Dam. So we've been continuing those sites just specifically to help monitor, you know, when the dam comes out, hopefully we'll be able to continue it after its removal. So we'll have a picture of what it was like before, and then we can look at what it's like when it comes out. Historically, these fish were in lots of these tributaries, you know, up as far as they could go. And when dams were put in, that stopped their migration. So the fish were not able to get to their natural areas like they used to be able to. So finding out where fish presence and absence is kind of helps management be able to figure out priority streams. And, you know, if fish were here historically and now they're not, maybe we need to do something about that.